Dear friends, welcome to this edition of VBS Osteo Med, a series of videos with narration on topics in osteology. In this video, we will cover the skull, Norma Lateralis, the normal lateral view, part 2, namely the intermediate zone or the temporal zone. You will recall in the previous video, we had divided the Norma Lateralis into an anterior, middle and posterior. In other words, you can as well call them as the face zone, temporal zone and the occipital zone. Now we will take up the middle zone or the temporal zone in this discussion. Now, we have already identified the frontal bone in the previous video. Nevertheless, a recap, the frontal bone is seen there in the upper part. On the other side is the parietal bone. Between the two is the coronal suture, as seen by those flashing arrows. That means the frontoparietal suture or the coronal suture is very clearly seen in the upper part of Norma Lateralis. It's one of the key features of this zone. Next, another important feature of this view, the temporal zone, Norma Lateralis, is the zygomatic arch. This arch is a bridge of bone between the zygomatic and the temporal bone. We will see a little detail in the next few slides. This bridge roughly divides this area, that is the temporal zone, into an upper temporal fossa, that is the larger circle shown here, and a lower infratemporal fossa. Now, the continuity between the temporal and the infratemporal fossa is obvious when I remove this bridge, namely the zygomatic arch, as seen in this skull. You can see the arrow, flashing arrow, which shows the continuity between. That means there is a gap between the lateral wall of the skull and this zygomatic arch, as seen in this roughly superior lateral view. That dark area encircled is the gap that connects the temporal and the infratemporal fossa. Through the gap, the temporalis muscle goes down, the tendinous part of this muscle goes and attaches to the coronoid process. Next, this zygomatic arch has two components. One is the anterior component, which is nothing but the temporal projection or the temporal process of the zygomatic bone, the lower flashing arrow, and the upper flashing arrow, namely zygomatic process of the temporal bone. That means these two bones give a process each, these two meet together, and the area that is encircled is the suture that is formed between the two bones, namely the zygomatico-temporal suture. Next, the temporal lines are another set of important features seen. The upper flashing arrow is the superior temporal line, but the other one, the inferior temporal line, is not shown by an arrow. It is shown by a dotted line, white and blue dashes. The inferior temporal line is slightly inner to the superior temporal line. The fascia and the muscle, that means the temporalis fascia and this muscle, the temporal fascia rather, and the temporalis muscle are attached respectively. The muscle is lower or on the inner aspect. This inferior temporal line, traced downwards and forwards, ends in a ridge which we call as the supramastoid crest. This ridge roughly runs at a tangent to the upper edge of the external acoustic meatus. As it does so, it is the superior border of a triangle which we will see in due course, the supramiatal triangle, that we will discuss a little later. It's time to identify a few important bones. Three flashing arrows. One, the greater wing of the sphenoid, the frontal process of the zygomatic, and the squamous part of the temporal bone. The frontal process of the zygomatic bone forms the anterior boundary of the temporal fossa. The other two bones, namely the greater wing of the sphenoid and the squamous part of the temporal, roughly forms the floor. Next, as these bone components are identified, parts of bones are being identified, there is an important junction that we need to know. It is encircled here and is called the pterion. It's called the pterion. When you analyze the components that participate in this junction, pterion, you will notice these four arrows. Correspondingly, a part of the parietal bone, a part of the temporal bone, part of the greater wing of the sphenoid bone, and the frontal bone. These four bones join to form a rough H-shaped suture or a junction called the pterion. It may be relevant to note that the thickness of the cortical bone here, it's rather thinner than the other parts of the skull. But more importantly, one is the thinness, more importantly, deep to this junction is present the middle meningeal vessels. The combination of these two, the cortical bone being thin and the vessel being there right underneath, in the event of a trauma, there can be a large subdural hematoma formation. Also note that right behind it are important cortical areas. So bleeding in these areas may manifest as cerebral symptoms. Next, in the infratemporal fossa, the plate of bone that virtually shows itself as the floor is the lateral pterygoid plate. Medial teat is the medial pterygoid plate, not very, very clearly visible in a strict lateral view, but I will show you another view where slightly the basalis, norma basalis is included. There we can identify. Other than that, on the other side, behind the external acoustic meatus or the opening, the mastoid process of the temporal bone is visible, and that's the flashing arrow there. Next, when you recheck the zygomatic arch, the posterior component of the arch formed by the temporal bone, the so-called zygomatic process of the temporal bone, there is an articular tubercle that forms a small half curtain. So much so, the area behind it is the mandibular fossa, into which the head of the mandible sits to form the temporomandibular joint. This articular tubercle acts as a small hump which prevents anterior dislocation of the head of the condyle. Next, a little more anteriorly, the other flashing arrow refers to a small slit just in the gap between the lateral pterygoid plate and the posterior aspect of the maxilla. There is a small slit. That slit is known as the pterygomaxillary fissure. When a probe is passed into that fissure, it leads to the pterygopalatine fossa. Next, right below and behind the articular tubercle, as mentioned a little earlier, the mandibular fossa is seen, that is shown here as a circled region, flashing circle. That's where the condyle of the mandible, condyle or process of the mandible, fits to form the temporomandibular joint. But forming the posterior wall of this same fossa is the tympanic plate, which is also the anterior wall of the external auditory meatus. That means this tympanic plate separates the external acoustic meatus from the mandibular fossa. Next, right below you can see a small horn-like projection. Actually, there are two, one on either side. Both are visible in this. That's the styloid process, a part of the temporal bone. Now you see, this, although labeled as Norma lateralis, is actually a little of basalis included. That means I have tilted the skull a little bit so that in addition to the typical Norma lateralis, a small component of the basalis, that is the basal aspect of the external skull, is also visible. This makes the understanding slightly better. Here you can therefore see the same lateral pterygoid plate in better view. The black area is the slit in front of it, not marked here, but it is very visible, blackish area. That is the, as I mentioned in an earlier part of this discussion, that is the pterygomaxillary fissure. Next, the lower flashing arrow is the medial pterygoid plate about which I mentioned earlier. And there is a small fossa or a small space between the two pterygoid plates. That space, not labeled here, but visible very clearly between the two arrow marks, that space is the pterygoid fossa. This is a very important add-on to our understanding, but the view is a mixed view. Next, you can still see that articular tubercle and the mandibular fossa. In this view, it's slightly better seen in this mixed view. Next, bounding the pterygomaxillary fissure, forming its anterior wall, is the posterior surface of the maxilla. As I told you, as you pass a probe into the pterygomaxillary fissure, you will reach the pterygopalatine fossa. The other flashing arrow, the arrow referring to the pitrotympanic fissure, is a very important slit or a gap. That fissure is known as pitrotympanic fissure. It's a junction where not only the two bone parts join, but there is also an edge of a third piece of bone, the petrous part of the temporal bone, located in this area. Now that fissure is the pitrotympanic fissure. I would welcome your feedback on this video. You can share it to my email ID, or better still, please type out your feedback on the blog area located below the YouTube video, so that everybody can can see the feedback. This is a presentation from the Department of Anatomy, St. John's Medical College, Bangalore, India. In addition to the osteology series of videos, there is also available VBS Histomed, a series of about 90 plus videos on the histology, human histology. It is useful for medical, dental, physiotherapy, nursing, and allied health students. I would recommend you to subscribe to this channel. Also, after the subscription, please click on the bell icon so that as and when additional videos are added, you will be notified. Thank you for your patient viewing of this video. I hope it has helped you in your subject. Thank you.